morning and welcome. As we come into God's presence, let us still our hearts and our minds as we pray together. Almighty God, we stand to sing our first hymn, number 208.
Thank you.
the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you. A very warm welcome to this Mass on as we keep the feast of Saint Benedict, an abbot from about 1500 years ago. A warm welcome to anyone who's joining us online today. Hopefully the technology may actually work a bit better this week than it did last week. We will get there in the end. God chose us in Christ before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and blameless before him in love. Let us confess our sins and failings and ask him who is rich in mercy for forgiveness and peace. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we have sinned against you and against our neighbour in thought and word and deed, through negligence, through weakness, through our own deliberate fault. We are truly sorry and repent of all our sins. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, who died for us, forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may serve you in newness of life, to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in life eternal, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Eternal God, who made Benedict a wise master in the school of your service and a guide to many called into community to follow the rule of Christ, grant that we may put your love before all else and seek with joy the way of your commandments, through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord,
who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
A reading from the book Proverbs. My child, if you accept my words and treasure up my commandments within you, making your ear attentive to wisdom and inclining your heart to understanding, if you indeed cry out for insight and raise your voice for understanding, if you seek it like silver and search for it as for hidden treasures, then you will understand the fear of the Lord and find the knowledge of God. For the Lord gives wisdom. From his mouth come knowledge and understanding. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. The response to the psalm is, incline your heart to understanding.
Incline your heart to understanding.
You only are my portion, O Lord. I have promised to keep your words. I entreat you with all my heart, be merciful to me according to your promise.
Incline your heart to understanding.
I have considered my ways and turned my feet towards your decrees. I hasten and do not tarry to keep your commandments.
Incline your heart to understanding.
Though the cords of the wicked entangle me, I do not forget your law. At midnight, I will rise to give you thanks because of your righteous judgments.
Incline your heart to understanding.
I am a companion of all who fear you and of those who keep your commandments. The earth, O Lord, is full of your love. Instruct me in your statutes.
Incline your heart to understanding.
A reading from the first letter of Paul to the Corinthians. According to the grace of God given to me, like a skilled master builder, I laid a foundation, and someone else is building on it. Each builder must choose with care how to build on it, for no one can lay any foundation other than the one that has been laid. That foundation is Jesus Christ. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
The Lord be with you.
Hear
the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Luke.
Glory to you, Lord.
A certain ruler asked Jesus, "Good teacher, what must I do to inherit eternal life?" Jesus said to him, "Why do you call me good? No one is good but God alone. You know the commandments. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not murder. You shall not steal. You shall not bear false witness. Honor your father and mother." He replied, "I have kept all these since my youth." When Jesus heard this, he said to him, "There is still one thing lacking. Sell all that you own and distribute the money to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. Then come, follow me." This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you.
May I speak to the glory of God, who is Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Quite often it's said that Christians are, all people are moral people. They've got morals. So I started wondering, well, where do we learn how to behave? How do we learn what is moral or ethical to do and what isn't? Now, Bridget, maybe you can help me. How do we learn how we should behave? We learn at school. That's good. Yeah. So we can learn how to behave from school. If I wander around, anyone else want to tell me any other ideas? Sorry? We learn from our parents. Yep. So we've got school. We've got parents. We learn by example. Excellent. That's sort of school and parents and just sort of observing as well somehow, isn't it? We learn from books. Yeah, books can tell us how to behave. Anything else? Any thoughts? Any thoughts of how we learn? How do we learn what's right to do and what's not right to do? I heard the Bible said. Yeah, so we've got a few things. We've got our parents, we've got school, we've got books, we've got example, we've got the Bible. So many different ways we can learn. We learn from other people. We learn from following their example. Right on this site here, or maybe just over the other side of that wall. As you'll know, there was once a Benedictine priory. A priory, a community of monks following the rule of St. Benedict. It was a priory because it was a daughter community to Mont Saint-Michel in France. That was an abbey, it had an abbot, and then they sent out smaller groups of people into churches called a priory, where they're under a prior rather than an abbot, linked to the mother church. So there were some monks here following the rule of Benedict. St. Benedict, as I said earlier, was a monk who lived around 1,500 years ago. He wrote a rule. He wrote a guidebook on how the community should live, because like so many other people, he was concerned about how we live our lives and in a community how people live together. Now I wonder who sometimes, maybe you won't want to put your hand up, but who finds it sometimes a little bit difficult living with other people under the same roof? I know I do, because I'm awkward at the best of times. And in a monastery, whether an abbey or a priory, it's like that, but multiplied a million times. I'm an oblate of Alton Abbey, and I hear stories from monks about quite what it's like sometimes because you're living in an enclosure, you're all trying to do the same things, you can't escape from each other, and so you get annoyed and you start doing stupid things if you're not careful. I remember when I was training for ministry at Cudston, we had a former monk who came to lead a quiet day, and he told a story over how two monks had a punch-up over breakfast in silence. One of them wanted something passed over to them, whether it was butter or whether it was pepper, I can't remember. So he tried to, say, we're eating in silence. He tried to give a sign, can you pass that over? And the other one ignored him. And so he was a bit more over the top, and he was ignored again. And in the end, he got so annoyed with it, he just punched the other person. That's the tension that we can have in any kind of community. And so Benedict was concerned with this, how people should live their lives when they're living together. A book of rules, a book helping people to live. Actually, in our homes, if we're living with other people, or even if we're living on our own, we've probably got some rules about how life has to go on. Maybe who has to go, what order people go to the bathroom in the morning when getting ready so it works properly. Or what order people have breakfast, or who does dishes or empties dishwasher, or who takes turns when to do cooking or cleaning. There's all kinds of rules. Sometimes discussed, sometimes it just happens in our lives. I wonder what rules there are that you live your life by. Maybe at home, maybe in other parts of your life. Saint Benedict's rule was written mainly for monks, but it's useful for all Christians too, as we think about how we have our shared life as a community. So I wonder what rules maybe could we have for the congregation here at the Vale? Maybe we have some already and we just don't think about it. Maybe there's some that we should pick up. I suppose one rule is the choir go forward first to receive communion at the altar rail. Because if they didn't, it would be difficult for them to be doing the singing during communion if they hadn't already received communion. There's loads of other rules, and maybe that it's a chance for us to think afresh at how we should live our life together as a community here at the Vale. But back to St. Benedict, back to his rule. He had various things in it. I could read it all out. We've not got time. Devotion to regular prayer, getting up to get to pray together at certain times every day. Study of the scriptures, study of the Bible. But it wasn't all just stay your time in prayer in the community all the time. There were rules about doing physical work, manual work, going out, not just staying inside. There were rules about food, rules about not eating too much. Probably rules that apply to most of us at times. Rules also about hospitality, about welcoming others, feeding them, not just keeping it all to yourself. Rules about stability. Generally, a monk would stay in that same community for the whole of their life, not diving from one place to another place to another place. Probably something that applies to many people here who have been worshipping here at the Vale for most of their life. There's a wonderful bit about it in the rule, about if you are an artisan, if you're a craftsman, if you've got a particular skill that you're really, really good at doing something, maybe something that makes money for you or for the abbey. And he says, if you're a really skilled artisan, but it's all going to your head and you're doing it because you think, aren't I wonderful? I'm doing it for my own glory. Benedict says, if that's happening, just stop it. Stop doing it. You've got to be banned from doing that, even if you're good at it, because You need to have humility, and it's not about you. Also, there were rules about decisions and about authority. An abbey was under an abbot, who's the boss, like a bishop, but for a community. A priory has a prior who's underneath an abbot. An abbey has a prior as well, who's sort of the second in command. But there are people of various different ages, various different experiences in the abbey or in the monastery. And Benedict says, when you're making a decision, we don't just say whoever's been there the longest or whoever the abbot is says what happens. He says, no, you meet together, all of you. You discuss it. And all the voices are equally important. And he says something quite remarkable. It may well be that the youngest person, the person or the person who's only just arrived, may be the one who is speaking God's word, speaking God's plan. I repeat that. It may be the youngest person or the newest person who is actually speaking God's word to that community. So we need to listen to those who are newest, who are youngest, as they've got just as much right to share things, and they may be the person God is using to pass on a message. What an incredible insight from Benedict. And as we prepare for our annual meeting during the family mass next Sunday, I think that's something for us to bear in mind. Not just saying, well, the rector or the church wardens or the church advisory committee know what's right or what we should be doing. Actually, what do our young people think? What do those who haven't been here for very long think? Because actually, God might be using them. God might be speaking through them. This was all Benedict's rule for those that community, for a community of monks. But also, much of it applies to us in our lives as Christians and lives as a community. We see in the gospel reading a ruler coming to Jesus, look, what must I do to inherit eternal life? What must I do to live my life better, to conform more to God's plan? And then in the epistle, we hear about the church being built up like a building. Foundation being put down and then building blocks up on top of it. It's what we're doing here as a community. We're building God's kingdom. We're not just doing it because we quite fancy going to church on a Sunday and we like meeting together. We're doing it because we're worshipping God and making his kingdom known. And Paul says, when you're building the church, the foundation has got to be Jesus Christ. That's the only foundation we can have. That is what this is all pointing to. We're living our lives, we're being church, we're worshipping God because of Jesus, because of making him known. That was what Benedict's rule was focusing on. Living as a community with God at the center, with worship of Jesus Christ, with building up his church. And that also is what we are called to do here in the Vale. As we listen to what God is saying to us, as we work together, as we are church in this place, may we be open to God's plans for us. And may his will be done, and may his church be built up here and now. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. So let us stand as we declare our faith in God, who is Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ,
the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father, through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate from the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and was made man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic and Apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Let us pray.
Our minds are so often full of words, and what is worse, our hearts are often clogged up with thoughts and ideas as well, which leaves little room for meeting God in simplicity and stillness. So this morning, we are going to make space in our minds to pray by ourselves, guided with spoken prayers. Please don't fear the silences, but experience the closeness you feel to God during that time. Let us first clear our minds to make space for clarity of prayer. Take a moment to focus on your breath and take a couple of normal, deep breaths in and slowly out. Let go for this moment of any thoughts that are clouding your mind so that you can be prepared to make your prayers here. Lord of creation, we admit that sometimes we can miss the glory of your created world. We can walk through life with our senses turned off. Give us, we pray, the gift of caring contemplation, so that we may see all things touched with your glory, the morning sun rising over our islands, the endless shades of light and darkness in the evening sky. How much we take for granted, yet how much our lives have been blessed with enjoyable experiences and good people. In silence, pray for those you know who need God's glory to shine upon them at this time. Lord, in your mercy. God, our Father, we share our love and concern for the Church as we pray for Trevor, our Bishop, Tim, our Dean, and Stuart, our Rector. We pray for churches everywhere who give soul to community life and the well-being of their congregations, particularly for all here in the Vale. We delight in the richness of our heritage here over so many years. In silence, we lift our eyes to the deifying light and open our ears to the heavenly voice that hears our prayers, as we give thanks for the Church and for all who are faithful in their day and compassionate to need. Lord, in your mercy. Between us all, we know so many people who are struggling today with personal crises and illness. Lord, may your healing power come to all who are in despair through mental or physical ill health, loneliness or uncertainty about life. In silent reflection, we pray for anyone we hold dear in our hearts. Let us also show our own love and concern for those who have asked for our prayers. Hilary Brown, Josh Barbe, Julia Bentley, Father John Widows, Janet LePage, Pat Smith, Molly LeGarf, Tony Hammond, Barry Linacore. Lord, in your mercy. We remember those who we have loved that have passed before us and ask you, dear God, to give peace to those who mourn. We remember those whose anniversary of death falls around this time. Jenny Edwards, Frederick Bubb, Robert Smith, Shirley Grove, Jean Wakeham, Doreen Simon, Brian Hockey, Brian Tostevin, Charles Frossard, Ronald Fowler, Rita Davidson, George De La Haye, Iris Mercier, Amanda McLaughlin, Jason Ozan, Patrick Warren. Lord, in your mercy. Lord, these are the prayers of your people this morning. We ask you to take each one of our prayers that are offered with honesty in our hearts. We have a final moment of silence to take a breath deeply and slowly to focus on the glory of God in our lives. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son.
So we stand for the peace. Jesus says, "Peace I leave with you, my peace I give to you. I do not give to you as the world gives. The peace of the Lord be always with you."
Thank you.
Pray, my brothers and sisters, that this, my sacrifice and yours, may be acceptable to God the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and the good of all his church.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts. Give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give thanks and praise.
It is indeed right and good, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Jesus Christ our Lord. This day we honour you in Saint Benedict, who consecrated his life to the Church, to Christ, for the sake of the kingdom of heaven. In him you show us your saving love, as you call the human race back to its first holiness, and invite us to taste on earth the gifts of the world to come. In communion with angels and archangels and all who served you on earth and worship you now in heaven, we raise our voice to proclaim your glory, forever praising you and singing. Holy indeed, the source of all holiness. Grant that by the power of your Holy Spirit and according to your holy will, these gifts of bread and wine may be to us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, who, the same night that he was betrayed, took bread and gave you thanks. He broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup and gave you thanks. He gave it to them, saying, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Great is the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. And so, Father, calling to mind his death on the cross, his perfect sacrifice made once for the sins of the whole world, rejoicing in his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension, and looking for his coming in glory, we celebrate this memorial of our redemption. As we offer you this, our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, we bring before you this bread and this cup, and we thank you for counting us worthy to stand in your presence and serve you. Remember, Lord, your church in every land. Reveal her unity, guard her faith, and preserve us in peace. Rejoicing in the Holy Spirit, your whole church offers thanks and praise together with Justin, our Archbishop, Trevor, our Bishop, Tim, our Dean, Giles, Abbot of Alden, and all those whose lives bring hope to this world. Lord of the living and the dead, awaken to the undying light of pardon and peace those who have fallen asleep in faith, and those who have died alone, unloved and unmourned. Send the Holy Spirit on your people, and gather into one in your kingdom all who share this one bread and one cup, so that we, in the company of the Blessed Virgin Mary, Saint Michael, Saint Benedict, and all the saints, may praise and glorify you forever, through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
By whom and with whom and in whom, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honour and glory be yours, Almighty Father, forever and ever.
Let us pray with confidence, as our Saviour has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. Though we are many, we are one body, because we all share in one bread. Lamb of God, behold him who takes away the sin of the world. Blessed are those who are called to his supper. Lord, I am not worthy to receive you, but only say the word, and I shall be healed.
May the Lord Jesus bless you and keep you and encourage you every day. May the Lord Jesus bless you and keep you and show you what amazing things that you can do for you.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Merciful God, who gave such grace to your servant Benedict, that he served you with singleness of heart and loved you above all things, help us, whose communion with you has been renewed in this sacrament, to forsake all that holds us back from following Christ and to grow into his likeness from glory to glory through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Almighty God, we thank you for feeding us with the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him we offer you our souls and bodies to be a living sacrifice. Send us out in the power of your Spirit to live and work to your praise and glory. Amen. Please sit for the notices.
Warm welcome to any visitors here this morning. Please join us for refreshments to be served after the service. All these services the forthcoming week are on the news sheet. Can I just point out the big notes at the bottom? See the important notes on the back of the leaflet, one of which is Reverend Penny Graysmith, who's been appointed dean by the dean to serve as vice dean, is being admitted to a role at Evensong at the Town Church today at 6:30 p.m. Please do come along and support Penny. She did some marvellous work for us during the interregnum, and I know we look forward to seeing her and hearing a word from her at the end of the month while Stuart takes a well-earned rest, and Natalie and Bridget, of course. As you can see, there'll be the annual church meeting during the family mass. I know Father Stuart will say something more about that after the notices. One thing I forgot to put on the news sheet, and we have to affirm our safeguarding policy. This is in the porch. If you could please have a quick look at it as we go out, and something we can have to affirm next Sunday. Can anyone tell me what would normally be happening today at about 1 o'clock? Second Sunday in July?
Lunch.
Yeah. Anything else? Something more important than lunch? Strawberries and cream, does that ring a bell? Wimbledon finals? No? Well, poor Rosemary, she hasn't been able to watch Wimbledon, so she's had a glut of strawberries. So she's made some strawberry jam to be sold in aid of Torero. Is it in the porch, Rosemary? In the porch. If you haven't got any money, she will take IOUs. There'll be a 5% surcharge added. And also, just to remind those who've got any tubes for Torero, I know one came back this morning at the 8 o'clock. If you've got any tubes, please bring them back so that we can send the money on to Torero. Right, birthdays. Well, we've got three. One was yesterday, Pat, wasn't it? Yes. One is Thursday, Barbara. And Shirley, I'm not sure which day yours is. Wednesday. Are there any other birthdays? Very quiet. No? Thank you, Andrew.
So, annual meeting. We have to have it each year. Normally it's by the end of April, but something happened with a virus or something, so we were delayed and realised that it needs to be done by the end of this month. So actually it seemed an ideal opportunity to have it during the concert, within the context of worship, rather than the business being added on afterwards for those who like that kind of thing. Actually, It affects all of us, so it seemed right to have it within worship. First thing to say is don't worry, the Mass won't suddenly go on for 3 hours because the order of service is adapted to make sure that the time won't be very different to normal. It can't be, we've got a baptism afterwards. So that encourages me, if I want a cup of tea, to make sure things don't go on too long. So at the start of Mass, after we've had the greeting before the confession, we'll hear some short reflections, I hope, from Mike and Jeremy, as opposed to a long essay read out. There'll be some, I presume, a written report in the order of service for people to have what's happened, but actually just some short thoughts from the church wardens about what's happened during 2019. I'm having trouble remembering what happened in 2019, where it feels like a lifetime ago. During the sermon-ish slot, I'll be having some reflection on where we are as a church, as my sort of report kind of thing. Before the piece, before the offertory, Steve will again share a short reflection, but there will be more information printed in the order of service. And then at the end, within the notice slot, we will have the election of church advisory committee members. There's two people who are up for election this year. There's Nikki and there's Jane. Nikki says she's been on the church advisory committee since when the monks first arrived from Mont Saint-Michel. I think that's a hint she'd quite like a break for a year. But she will stand if other people don't, so have a think about that. And as Mike said, during the service, during the Mass also, we will be affirming the safeguarding policy. I'll probably print that in the order of service as well, so we've got it all in one place. It will probably be most appropriate to put that as part of my slot, I suppose, really, because putting it as any other business at the end says something about not feeling like we're taking it too seriously, which we are, because it's vital as we are all being the church that God is calling us to be, means caring for each other and actually making sure that we do things right. So please do come along. Young people matter as much as older people. Young people have thoughts that older people don't have. Old people have thoughts that younger people don't have as well. It goes both ways. So it's a Mass for everyone. The meeting is for everyone, not just a small subset. So I've probably forgotten to say something about that, so ask me afterwards. On Friday night, we had a quiz. Some of us were there. Within the quiz, there were 13 tables. I think it was three of the tables were vaguely church-related, weren't they? Yes. Yeah. And from that, how do I say this? The rector's table did the best of the church tables. We came third from bottom. But it was a really enjoyable time. And we raised a bit of money for the church. Anyone know how much we raised? Natalie does, of course. Anyone want a guess? 600. We've got 600, higher or lower? Sorry? 1,050. What a result. Thank you to everyone who's been involved with it. It was a really good event. We're going to try and make that annual with a music quiz, but also we wonder whether we might be able to have a non-music quiz as well at some point for those of us who don't really cope very well with all these questions about music, even if we're musicians. But yeah, those of you who didn't come, you missed out on something really good. So next time, put it in your diary earlier, or maybe we can arrange it earlier so we can actually do it. Shall we stand as we pray for God's blessing? The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Bow your heads and pray for God's blessing. God give you grace to follow his saints in faith and hope and steadfastness, And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you all. Go in the peace of Christ. Thanks be to God.